new chairman of the Zoning Board of Appeals, and we're here tonight for a continuation of a public hearing regarding case number 1602, the comprehensive permit hearing for MKM Reading LLC for the Reading Village proposed development. A little bit by way of how to meet, we expect the meeting to proceed tonight. We are now in our, what is it, fifth or sixth, I think, hearing on this. The project has been proceeding, it's been updated, and tonight we're here with a fairly full agenda. The way the meeting is going to go is that the applicant is going to have an opportunity to present any new information that they feel the board and the public would benefit from. We have in attendance tonight some town consultant peer reviewers who are going to update us all on their findings and recommendations regarding the project. We're then going to, and throughout the process, we're going to allow board members to comment and ask questions, and of course, any town staff have questions. Then we will have a public comment period where you will all be afforded an opportunity to speak, ask questions, and be heard. We're going to ask that you hold questions until that public comment period is open. And a quick reminder, you'll raise your hand if you have something to add. Please give your name and your address. Please address the board. Please obviously be respectful with your questions and comments so that we can keep the meeting organized. And with that, I guess I ought to just read the announcement. So tonight is, as I alluded to, a continuation of case 1602, the Reading Village comprehensive permit. We probably want to update the posting. The petition is on behalf of MKM Reading LLC, who seeks a comprehensive permit to develop, it's now 72 units of rental housing at the property that includes 3941 Lincoln Street, 212 Prescott Street, and I'm not even sure what that new address is, but the Brown parcel on the corner as well, the Brown's Auto Repair parcel. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to the applicant and his group to start the proceedings. Floor is yours.
Thank you, and good evening, Mr. Chair, members of the Zoning Board, department employees, and members of the audience. I'll be very brief. We don't really have much new information on our end. In the interim, we've got peer review reports from the architect, peer review consultants, which I don't actually see yet. And the traffic peer review consultant, we've had opportunity to review those, issue our own comments. I think some of the bigger issues in those reports, scale and impacts, the reports speak for themselves. And we know there's still a lot of work on the details that we'll continue to work with the peer review consultants and boards in town as we move through some of those details. Importantly, we're incorporating a lot of those comments into our civil engineering package. We're just putting the finishing touches on it. So some of the comments we've just received, we anticipate we'll be presenting that to the town at the beginning of the week for that civil peer review consultant to start review of that. So we know there's still other details too that we've now kind of finalized. We'll put together a maintenance and operation plan to talk about such things as trash removal and snow removal that are two important details, and then other details that still need to be finalized. I think now that we're kind of moving forward with the architect and traffic and the civil, we can start finalizing some of those details. We also have here tonight our landscape architect. The one change we've made since then is the peer review architect had some comments on landscaping. I'll let the landscape architect speak later on, but we've made some of those changes and we've added a fence to the rear of the property on the landscape plan. So we have our landscape architect here tonight. We look forward to getting into the peer reviews and finalizing some of the simple details as we move forward. So that's it. Thank you very much.
So with that, we ought to perhaps turn it over to the first of our peer reviewers.
Architects are not
Certainly, please. Make sure it works, batteries in it. You can always count on you.
Thank you, good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, public. My name is Bill Scully, I am with Ring International Affiliates. We were retained as the traffic peer review consultant for this project. And I'm just gonna give you.
Medical here. That would be easier.
Gonna give you a brief update. Jason Sobel from our office was here at a previous meeting and really, that was the initial review was going through the report in detail, the analysis assumptions and all of that. Since that time, we've had a chance to look at the responses from the applicant's consultant, as well as any changes to the plan that had been submitted. And as we heard tonight, there are still more things to take place. So in terms of the review process so far, we've done our initial review of the documents, like reconnaissance, any research. We made a report back in March to the town. Since that time, or after that, the applicant's traffic consultant prepared some responses to that. As I mentioned, the plan was modified a little bit. So we have reviewed that, reviewed the responses, and we prepared a follow-up report dated July 13th. That probably is in your packet.
Mm-hmm.
And we're really in the process of finalizing the review. There are some issues or things that have to be more analysis done or more defined. The new set of plans are expected in next week, and the remaining issues hopefully will be resolved at that point. The latest review, the July 13th report, as I said, is based on the some of the earlier, the June application material, the Vanas response that was again dated in March, but after our report. In general, and as you see in that latest report of ours, the bulk of the traffic analysis methods, assumptions, results have really been resolved. Any questions we have were responded to, and we're all on the same page of that. Really, the remaining items that still need some work is the parking issue related to what the demands may be at peak. What's the supply being proposed? How is it going to function? And then the design of that. So you'll see in the latter part of our report, we still either raise questions or items that indicate, you know, the information still needs to be provided, or if changes are going to be happening, then we need to know what those changes are or more supporting documents. We did have conversations with the applicant and their engineer and staff in the last couple of days. So we all know, I think, where we're headed and what needs to be done at this point, and we're going to wait and see the revised plans that come in next week. And I pretty much said this. I mean, the work that we have to do is to finalize, wrap up our review when the new information comes in. And it really does relate to the sort of the vehicle circulation design and the parking layout, and then finalize the mitigation program or what actions are going to be done. There's a number of items that were outlined in the reports and the applicant has stated, and we just want to make sure those commitments remain, or if there's any listed some of these. These are essentially listed in our July report and listed in the applicant's report back in the date of the original traffic report, but some of it is listed in that, as well as sort of evolving through recent discussions. So things like just making sure in terms of access is safely, type of control, visibility at the entry points, the plans that changed. One of the drives was one way in the original plan, and both drives out in the streets are two way now. You heard mentioned earlier an operations and maintenance plan will be developed, which deals with some of the trash related items, and that was brought up in our last report. And just the last few things, some of it again has been mentioned, and we just want to see commitments and how it's going to. Where it's going to be located, bike storage in the parking area. Potentially, we talked about theory, maybe some zip car spaces available, and the pedestrian movement from the parking area out. And with that, we can answer questions or maybe the architects.
While we're waiting for the if the applicant has any responses to that they would like to bring up right now, that'd be fine.
Yeah. So in terms of the mitigation measures, there's a number of good recommendations that have been made that we'll get into that will both be shown on civil plans and the operation and maintenance plan. And I think there'll probably be some more that come out in the process of sidewalks, crosswalks and stuff like that. The other big kind of item that we've been open in discussion with the traffic engineer in town is parking ratio. We did submit a general summary of that waiver request that basically identifies a couple of items such as comprehensive parking program that was prepared in 2009. I know it was a number of years ago now, but I think that report is still relevant. Recommends a maximum of one space per unit. Downtown area of Reading, MAPC, growing station areas, and potential transit-oriented development in Metro Boston, which identifies this site as a town and village TOD parking. The state's transit-oriented development district model bylaw, which also recommends one space per unit, as well as trying to accomplish some shared parking in downtown areas like Reading. And then we actually had conversations with the owner of 30 Haven Street and determined that their actual usage is about one space per unit there, which is less than what they were approved for, what they have in the building. And then we cited a couple of recent projects either built or approved that are now trending towards that have one space per unit. So we've talked to the town about providing some more data to back that up, which we'll look at, maybe a sample project that we could highlight for the town that we'll look at. It's not a concept we created, the one space per unit in a transit area. So we're just trying to gather more information. And we're on the, we want to be comfortable with our parking ratio as much as anyone else does. It's a part of marketing and viability of a project. So we'll continue to look at that item. So I just wanted to point that out. We did submit that memo. And then a lot of the other items are the radiuses and drive aisles and parking areas will incorporate in the civil the package that we're going to submit. So we looking for that. So the town peer review. We do have our landscape architect here. If you want to hear from him while we wait, or
yeah, let's keep it moving. So, I'm sorry, John. Go ahead.
The number of parking spaces that you have proposed in the new plan now becomes how many?
Right now, we're proposing 72 spaces for 72 units, and it didn't make me think of one more thing with that discussion. So, we did a parking utilization study just to see how many spaces were available in the immediate vicinity. Taking spaces across the street, some of the side roads, and we appreciate, was that there's plenty of spaces, obviously, downtown. The majority of the ones by the train are used, you know, obviously, for during commuter hours. The only hours that a visitor could not park there is from 6 a.m. to 10:30 a.m. So if somebody came at noon and there was a space there, they're allowed to park there. And they're allowed to park there at all hours except from November to April from 1 a.m. to 6 a.m. So there's hundreds of visitor spaces across the street at the train. Now, granted, during commuter hours, it's almost 100% full. There's, you know, probably starts filling in around 6 a.m. by 8, it's pretty full. But then, you know, in the evening, 4 to 6 to 8, it obviously opens up again. We also identified a couple of parking areas that are privately owned nearby that we'll have discussions with. So it's something we're continuing to work on, and our hopes is that we will, you know, make an arrangement to secure a few more spaces just to have them off-site, as well as the spaces that can be used that the town owns in the, you know, immediate 1 block radius from the site. So that's something we'll continue to work out those details on the town as we get more information.
But on-site right now, you're only accommodating 72 spaces, one per unit.
One per unit, in the building, on-site, yeah.
And that,
okay.
That includes handicap too, I believe.
Well, that's
yeah.
What I'm asking. Is handicap included in that?
So we, the code requires us to provide 3 handicap spaces. I think when TBA is here, they will confirm. We had a discussion with the Architectural Access Board. We're providing 4 spaces. So those spaces are, you actually, if you had 10 handicap people living in the property, you have to provide 10 spaces. So the minimum they say you have to show is 3. We're going to provide 4. So it's kind of a working process. I know Ken chatted with him.
Yeah, the way that the regs read actually is that for handicap parking, you have to be capable of providing 3 handicap spaces for the number of parking spaces we have. So essentially what that means is they don't have to be dedicated for handicap use. They have to be available for handicap use if and when that becomes an issue. So what we would likely do is if there were, when the building opened, if there were 2 handicap people and 2 people that weren't handicapped, only 2 of those would be designated handicapped. And as the building makeup changes, that has to meet the demand in the building. But from a design perspective, the Architectural Access Board requires that we put 3, that we're capable of providing 3 spaces. And we're capable of providing 4 at the moment.
But you are a commercial residential entity. So the standards by the state are specific about the number of spaces that could be counted as a handicap spot. Is that correct?
It's a residential entity, yeah, but yes, it's specific about what needs to be provided in terms of the size of that space and aisles around it.
A van space has to be provided as well, and those have different requirements. So I think we had this discussion with TBA, and I'm sure the
we actually followed up to clarify. We actually contacted the Architectural Access Board compliance officer. He deals with this every day to speak about this and make sure we fully understood the regulations. And after discussing, we felt pretty comfortable that we were meeting the requirements.
Okay. And you do not have any visitor spaces included in that. So
on-site.
We're talking about basically 76 spaces right now on site.
72,
including any. So they're going
to. The handicaps included in that, yeah.
68 plus 4.
I have to kind of laugh at that a little bit. I happen to be involved on a condo board. Moving spaces around like that is very difficult because being a rental property, people move in and move out. So the number of handicapped spots that might be on there could change virtually on a monthly basis, which creates a major problem. And on top of that, because you have all rental units, you will have guaranteed you will have somebody who needs to seek health care assistance on-site, and those people who are providing that healthcare need to have access to your facility. So, being on the practical side of things, I think, I don't know where this is all going, but I can tell you from the other side of it, the practicality of saying that you only need 72, one per, and that's your argument, and that's one of the requests that you're making for a waiver. And I won't even get into the loading zone, that's further down the road, but my question right now is, if you can only provide 72, how are you going to manage those 72 spaces? And the only way that I know of is that there is a rental restriction imposed on anybody renting units, that they can only have one parking space per unit, regardless of whether it's a 1-2 or a 3. And violation of that will have them, I don't know, but it has to go into the rental agreement to monitor. Otherwise, there's no way that anybody can monitor that and keep it going.
One thing that we found at 30 Haven was they do a buyback program. So, for instance, if somebody rents an apartment there and they don't have a vehicle, they can get a slightly reduced rent and then they can have a spot available for somebody.
That's fine. However you figure it out, there has to be something there to be able to monitor that, because I assume that once you complete, you're not going to be the owner of the development, and you're going to have a management, if you are, you're going to have a management company. The management company has to have a means of maintaining the 72 spaces. So that's why I guess I'm a little specific on what the number of spaces are. Services or things in the building that they need or don't have or want, and if they don't have them, they'll rent somewhere else. So we could run into some of that too, but we're very comfortable being 60 feet from the train station. That having one bedroom is a good fit there. But it's a point that we'll continue to look into details of how that works. Okay.
Thanks, John.
That's a good point.
Did I see that we have a peer reviewer that showed up? We ask that they take the floor now and prepare.
I site. Of course, as you see here, the project itself has been filled in by the corner parcel, which gives an opportunity for us to consider a much more efficient internal configuration for the building and actually a more positive presentation to the community as well. So starting with the site observations, as we had observed before, the site itself is very good, well located for a project of this sort. It is classically what might be called a TOD, a transportation-oriented development, so close to the MBTA station. It has a number of amenities all around, as you folks know better than we, but there's a park there, it's close to commercial. It really does present itself well. The density has changed, the unit mix has changed, as you're perhaps aware. In this case, as presented in their submission, the density has gone down from 92.4 units an acre to about 73 units an acre. That represents a 21% reduction in density. Another way to look at it, if you look at the unit mix, previously the 76 units proposed, now down to 72. But in fact, when you look at the number of bedrooms, which to some extent reflects the number of people that are actually occupying the site, the total number of bedrooms has gone down from 113 down to 93. So that is an 18% reduction in absolute terms, the number of people that are involved at the street and creating an impact in the immediate environment. This density as proposed is about 5% lower than Haven, which is, of course, a project you're all familiar with. So that does create a reference point, and perhaps one way to consider these two projects together is they may be starting to develop a density limit for this kind of project or multifamily development in the area. We consider, as we continue to observe, I'm sorry, the multifamily housing is an appropriate use for this site, and to the extent that we're looking at other the community may be looking at other projects in the future, this is starting to develop a scale. The next slide would be, we started to look at landscaping. This is a section of the landscaping plan that's been proposed. You'll note that the site proposes, or at least would have, shrubs running along Prescott Street, along the sidewalk there, and also here, and then also that would disrupt the sidelines from the abutters. Comments that we have in relation to this, we did have this project reviewed by a landscape architect in our office who has made some suggestions to consider on the landscape. More specifically, the types of shrubs that are proposed here tend to grow out, whereas it's so close and proximate to the sidewalk that's running along, we suggest that they would consider shrubs that would grow more narrowly and vertically. Also, the landscape around the entrances is mostly evergreen, and the suggestion here is perhaps a little more ornamental treatment is possible. And the last observation on this is, although the greenery here as proposed is very sun-loving, and this is the south face of the site, so it's logical, but there are also, we observe, very substantial trees growing to the south of the building, and so in that regard, we just encourage the designers to consider, look at that and just determine whether there's enough sun for those shrubs they're choosing. Briefly, on scale and building elevations, you've all seen many of these, and we'll go through them very quickly, but just to characterize them, what's being proposed now is a mix of a masonry structure which has a flat roof and a short eave that extends over it, and then a series of masses of clapboarded and mansard roof structure with dormers above on the fourth floor. There are, if you just scroll through one or two of these, you'll see a good number of commercial storefront glass that's proposed at the corner of the two streets intersecting it. One of the things stated in the proposed, in the submitted schedule, is that the building is listed as 45'2" as the roof ridge, which is approximately the same height as the building that exists there now. We do observe a little bit, and if you could go perhaps to the next slide or two, this is nothing much here to talk about, but it's more insane with the mansard and the masonry. Again, the mansard on the corner. This aerial shot, looking at the existing structure, the new building then extends right across that corner at about that same height. We consider this to be a significant improvement for the community. The scale is much better, and one of the ways that we can identify that is looking at the sun studies that they provided. One of the things you'll see is that the area that the shadows fall pretty consistently and onto the next, this is the summer, the next, all of these areas are paved areas. If the shadows have to fall anywhere, they're falling where there's parking, where there's street traffic, not on the residences. The only spot that you really see an impact is the winter solstice, which is the next slide, where in the morning in particular, the project does throw its shadow across the way, impacting some of the residences. But even there, the majority of the sun is where paving is. And again, when you consider that the original building, the current structure, remains at about this height and about this location, there's a fairly small, where the changes take place, is across Prescott's, excuse me, across Lincoln, and into the parking area. So we do consider that much improved. Continuing on, this is the civil plan, and one of the things they note here, this particular structure, I'm mostly putting this here to orient folks. The building is shown on the site, as you see, and the vehicular movement through it is under the building, behind the building, which is above, open to the sky, back under the building and out. There's, you can also go to Lincoln Street and go likewise. This does allow for a two-way circulation throughout. There is parking on the site. There's more parking on the site. As far as, we'll talk about vehicular movement a little bit later, but I did want to consider that as we look here, you'll notice the paved area and also the park area, which is, doesn't come through on the side particularly well, as well as more parking here. If we go to the next slide, you'll see this is the elevation. Actually, it's enlarged, I see. But the elevation that I think has been presented to you is a little bit smaller and shows the full width of the building. But one thing we observe about this is it seems to be set. This is a view from the rear of the neighboring properties looking to the back of the structure. And we have suggested as one of the modifications to explore, there are no vehicles shown here. There's no paving shown here. It's as if it were a sea of green, which is actually misleading, I would say. It's not inaccurate, strictly speaking, but it needs to be looked at more carefully in that regard. One other thing that you'll see is the back surface of the windows that appear on the facade of Lincoln, and I'm sorry, Prescott rather. And because of course this is all the parking area underneath the building, and there are no cars shown. So would really change the view that you see. You'd be much more aware of the cars and paving, and so that should be looked at a little more. We understand also, though, we had a conversation, as was alluded to a little earlier, with some of the development team a couple of days ago to review some of the comments we made on the report. And one of the things stated was that they're also considering a fence for that back property, and that would also be something that would affect this view. This is a section of the building as proposed, and we want to make just a couple of observations about it, which will be useful to look at in other ways as we look more at the building elevations themselves. You'll see that the garage is shown here with a total structural height to the top floor of 12 feet. Speaking to the team, the current estimate is that they're about 7'6" of clear space under the building as you drive. You'll recall that when we were looking at the building, you saw that all vehicles had to go under the building to go across the back portion of the site and then out. If you're going in from Prescott and out to Lincoln or the other way, in every instance, you're crossing underneath the building. So that 7'6" height is the constraint for vehicles moving around the site. The total building height, as characterized here, is 47 feet. One thing, if we expand a little bit the section, you'll see the total roof height at 47. That is the upper edge of the pitched roof as you see it behind. You'll notice here an area which is actually behind that. It looks about 2 feet more. Mm-hmm. That's the brick section at the corner. And anywhere the brick section is where that flat roof, and that's actually the little eave extension that I mentioned. So I'd say that at least based on this, the actual height of the building, maximum height of the building is 49 feet. That's a little more than was indicated in the schedule, but that's still within the range of the existing structure. One other thing that this this building illustrates is the cut of the roof right there, which is the dormer component. Like, you can see that here. Here's the sloped roof of the mansard, and the dormer is for the fourth floor apartments. And so you see the dormer sticking out and coming down. That's where the window fits, right there. And then you have the pitch of the roof that intersects it. This illustrates that a little more precisely. You can see how the dormer fits into it. These windows are approximately 6 feet tall, and they extend to 18 inches above the floor, which is an elegant but unusual sill height. One of the things we observe about the fourth floor is that because the roof pitches where the dormer isn't, there is a sort of a gable interior, an eave that cuts. And we attempt to illustrate that here. These are the areas in red where those rooms actually cut back a little bit. That may affect the furnishability of some of these rooms, and we only suggested that be considered and looked at a little more carefully. The other thing we note, which we'll talk about just in passing, is that the kitchen is built into the dormer on the ends of the building right here. One thing I would like to say about this, we consider these windows to be very nice. They work well on the building. They're elegantly long. It's a nice feature, and so we encourage them to keep that. Financial imperatives tend to make things shorter, and then maybe people want to raise the sills, and that's perfectly reasonable, but it does change the appearance of the building, so it's just something we want to observe as a positive feature. Continuing on, that little bit that I mentioned about the red affecting the occupancy, one of the things we know in the unit mix summary is that where you have the A-type units, which are all the fourth floor units, some of them have a total square footage reduction, in this case of 8 square feet of reduction, this one 4 square feet of reduction. Not sure about that. If the come back at some point if it starts to get a little low. Maybe that's fewer square feet. We only observe that such a small percentage reduction. You may want to just double check those numbers. But one concern that also we would have, and I'm sorry, if you could go back one slide. The way this roof is cut back works well. One way to solve that loss of square footage is to steepen the roof so that it doesn't cut into the space as far, but that would affect the massing and the sense of the building as it is, so that's another thing which I think folks have done a constructive effort here, and it would be helpful to keep that as it is, so we encourage that. Going back forward again one more time. One other brief thing, you'll notice that, as I mentioned, the kitchens are built into the wall here, and you'll see that this wall extends all the way around the full perimeter of the building. The dormer, that's the end, this is the view looking this way at this facade. This dormer is drawn as if it were cut back, recessed, in order to raise the sill as necessary for the kitchen cabinets. The window sill makes sense where it is, but in fact, you probably don't want to lose the length of that stretch of building right there. You really want that, the square footage there, which may mean that this dormer would actually be brought forward like it is here. Underneath it, it would just be the clapboard rather than the, so you wouldn't necessarily have to change the sill, but that's a small thing I wanted to mention just to make sure that in fact the intent is what the plan says as opposed to what the elevation says. Civil. One point we wanted to make just to clarify for folks. The plan as proposed has setbacks that are identified on the civil. They're too small for you to see here, but I did want to summarize for you what is being proposed by way of an easement or variance on the setbacks. The front yard is zoned at 15 feet, and it is being proposed to the front yard minimum dimension is 4'10". The backyard setback, normally required to be 20 feet, is being brought back to 13.5, at least it's again the narrowest point. And the side yard, which is normally 20 feet, is brought back to 16.7. The only comments that we have about this is just to verify, of course, with the town that the setback changes proposed are indeed acceptable, and then the other is double check the site program. And we'll talk a little more about this relating to vehicular access and service vehicle movement. One quick thing, we didn't talk specifically, and we can't talk specifically about materials as proposed. What we see here appears to be, as I mentioned before, a brick mass with a very generous storefront running along the corner, a clapboard of some sort, a clapboard material here, double hung windows, bracketed soffits under a mansard structure. This all looks good to us, and we think they're nice choices. So again, something that we said the last time, as projects proceed, value engineering progresses, substitutions are made that have the same appearance but don't necessarily have the same longevity, and we just encourage folks to have continuing scrutiny on that, but as proposed here, it looks fine. I think at least we think the building complements the neighborhood. Continue again. Ground floor, now I want to talk about utility movement through it. You have here a central trash area. You have here the vehicle access onto Lincoln and Prescott, and we mentioned the traffic flow and the height restrictions that move throughout the site here, throughout the structure and the site. As it is, there's no provision for garbage trucks or any service vehicles pulling over out of the traffic. As the building is configured have to assume, and but this is a question, I guess, whether garbage vehicles can make that passage and make those turns, and if not, if they're pulled over, this would seem the most logical place to bring the trash out. But this is a busy street. There's no provision for a pull-off there, so that is a concern for us. This also relates to moving vehicles, which is something we talked about last time as well. There are 72 units. People come and go. There's going to be times when people have to pull trucks in. Whether there's enough room under the structure to accommodate that is a question, I guess, that just needs to be answered. We would say there are a couple possibilities. One would be to raise the floor height of the first floor to create more clearance space underneath it. But of course, I shouldn't say of course, but it would presumably every foot you raise the first floor up, you raise the roof up as well. So that has an impact on the building appearance. The availability of the pull-off space for service vehicles is important, and perhaps one of the most important concerns that we have. Other related observations, emergency vehicle access have the same constraints. We encourage folks to confirm with local public safety officials that this suffices, that it's acceptable to them. Snow removal and storage is very limited. The only open space that isn't taken, at least with the current plan, is there. There might be the opportunity to have limited snow storage there, but for the most part, the need to move snow off the site is necessary. What we're encouraging here is just having a management plan worked out both for trash, for the snow storage, for all of these things, so that people understand just how it's working. Parking, this actually provides that. And when we came in, there was some conversation about the accessible spaces. There are four here. Strictly speaking, there are three required for the 72-unit facility, but it's a curious thing, there are four accessible units required, and only three parking spaces required. In this case, they provided four, as they have the private parking number of units. In our conversation, there was a question that we raised about the how that works under the barriers board regulations. Like, what does an accessible unit, accessible parking space require? As we all know, you park in one, you get a ticket right away, and that's not the kind of thing you want to have. In this case, as was discussed, we confirmed that, in fact, MAB's rules are, first of all, that the space be potentially made accessible. You don't even need to have a sign, you don't need to have the striping at this point until it's needed, and then it could be done. That as far as the regulations are concerned, the potential that it could be applied is sufficient. The other point made is that there may be ways of organizing a sort of proprietary interest in it, but at least at this point, and this is another comment that we'll make, since there are no visitor spaces in this lot, there's no issue about people parking there that don't have the right to park there, because they will be designated parking spaces, or at least presumably there will be. One thing we observe here when we're talking about parking, there's no place here designated for bicycle parking. That might be something to consider. This is a transportation-oriented site. It's perfect. If you could have bikes here, people could, that would encourage a different kind of movement, maybe fewer parking spaces needed as a consequence. Next. One of the things that was talked about was the curbing, and this shows in the purple line the proposed curb for Prescott. Here's a picture of the condition before we were here last, and I'm sure this has not changed. We haven't verified this, but this is the way the community uses it. As it is, the actual edge of street is out here, and the cars are parked where the sidewalk needs to be. As proposed, with the occur will push the cars to the point where it will have a significant impact on through traffic. Our observation then is that all of the parking, and we estimated that there were 8 spaces available here, admittedly when the site is not used, but the community has grown to accustomed to that parking. So there will be an impact, the loss of those 8 spaces, with the curb in particular, that would make it quite problematic. We mentioned the earlier on-site pick-up and drop-off concern, and that remains on this street facade as well. And it does appear that the way the building has been reorganized with its main entrance and its elevators here, that most of the coming and going activity will take place up on Lincoln. So by way of recommendations, we say consider finding an on-site pickup and drop-off utility on the site. Seek a solution that doesn't result in the reduction of existing neighborhood parking, and consider a dimension of what we call healthy building design, which is bicycle storage. On next, one thing, if I may, this is an enlargement of the building plan. I just wanted to spot this, and I'm only looking for confirmation from the team in this regard. This is an enlargement of the site plan you're just looking at, or the structure plan, or the ground level plan. These are the structural columns shown, which is very useful at this point and realistic. But you'll note that the elevators appear to be opening not into the club space, but into the parking space, and in fact, directly onto the column. We assume that's not the case. We assume the elevators are intended to be operating on the club, and if you go to the next slide, you'll see this is the landscape plan, which does show the elevator opening onto the club. I have little doubt this is just the example of, you know, people moving plans back and forth and plans change, but in other conversations that we've had with the team, the landscape plan was the older one, because that one was showing that stairway that was in the wrong place in the middle of the building. So since this is an older plan and the other one is newer, just wanted to make sure that decisions hadn't been made that made that provision. It would seem illogical to us to have the elevators open directly onto a parked car. There's no space in front. It wouldn't work, so I assume it's fair to say that's not the case.
That's right.
Okay. To continue, one of the things that we wanted to talk about a little bit was the didn't switch my pages while I was talking, and so now I'm going to double check. One other point, I'm sorry if we go back one, just a quickie. We observed that this space here has not been programmed. We've been considering that it would function somewhat as a building lobby. Here's the vestibule entrance, as you'll recall, off of Lincoln, and you can pass into what's called a leasing area and another into the club area. It hasn't been programmed to date, and again, assuming that the elevators are opening into the space, one of the functions we assume that this space would evolve to is a building lobby of some sort. If it is a building lobby, we encourage reconfiguring the stair just a little bit in some way, because you'll note here the way the stair works. You walk in off the street and then begin to go up stairs. And this is a half-height landing. You can also pass directly through into the parking area underneath. We would encourage reconsideration so that the stair would enter off the lobby so that you could approach an elevator to go upstairs or a stair to go upstairs. Make the stair more a part of the building life. You want to encourage people, again, this is part of what we call healthy design at this point, that you're looking to encourage people to use stairs when they're able to. And so to come in, check your mail, go upstairs, as opposed to come in, check your mail if that's where it's going to happen, and then go outside, and then go in, the stair would be offered. And so it would be one suggestion there. Another, and this is just, again, maybe cleaning things up a little bit, you notice that the stair here takes you up this way, and then this suggests down. In other words, this suggests to mention about the use of those common spaces. As you see here, there is this very commercial feeling facade, which seems appropriate for us at this intersection. It's directly opposite the train. It's a great expression of the commercial function. In this area here is the leasing area. Around here is the club. We think there's an opportunity there. Neither of those functions, as we understand them, would, you know, need a lot of window space per se. But as a consequence, there may be an opportunity to have community postings, ways of connecting to what's going on in the neighborhood. It's just the thought we wanted to offer. So our only recommendations here is to consider, you know, continue to consider the use of the club and leasing space to clarify how it's working. Also consider a separate entry that allows direct access from the residents to the stair using the lobby. Continue on. Some very brief comments on the elevator lobbies, which are here. There are sufficient space. We noticed that now that the building has been combined and sort of rationalized in its organization, we also see two elevators. That's a much more appropriate number. Is suitable for the function, the number of people here. We do observe that the lobby is tight. It's very efficient. It also has tight corners to turn for folks with carts. So we may want to consider a little bit of easing of that. And we do observe this longer door here. It's about 200 feet. And it's uninterrupted and somewhat unrelieved. And so we would encourage thinking about how to make public spaces in the building a little more amenable. We do observe that there's sufficient area in the elevator, importantly, for emergency vehicles, emergency use, emergency medical use, emergency fire use, so that's entirely satisfactory. And finally, just looking at these plans here, we just want to talk a little more about the trash and the recycling. We have confirmed that something which in our report we weren't sure about, namely that these are chutes that go down to that lower space in the basement. It's a fairly tight space. There are two chutes there, which is predicated on the idea of single stream recycling, so that you have your trash and your recycling and just drop it down two chutes. So I understand that that is the plan for the town, but this design is built, is predicated on that. And that if that were to change, this would be a little bit of a problem. But I also observed that there are a number of other spaces available that could be used should you wish to expand and change the flexibility there. So we just, again, want to observe that and, encourage the group to offer a management plan about how the trash is being handled, and this would be a part of that picture. To the next, we're back to that lower level plan, and we're here again. That is where the trash drops down to, and the trash then is stored here in this space. And there is some room to work around here, but then the pair of double doors leads you to the drop off. Now, if trucks can come by here, that works quite well. But if not, we're back to that question that we had about how that's handled exactly. Other than that, we can say that egress stairs work. They provide legal and safe egress. The size of the trash recycling facilities are tight, but they can be made to work. We're fairly confident. And that's pretty much it. Questions?
Not from the board. Does the applicant have any feedback based upon peer reviews that you'd like to share?
Just briefly on a couple points.
I'm sorry, before you do, could I just ask too, just for a point of clarification, if you are a member of your team, we obviously know who you are, you've been here an awful lot. If you or your member of your team would like to speak, please, just for the record and the stenographer, please just identify yourself. Yeah. Thanks. We know who you are.
I apologize, but yes, Matthew, so just real quick, there was a good point on the rear elevation. I think we talked about last time. It was a shot more from, you know, looking from the neighbors. Clearly, it didn't show didn't show any proposed landscaping or fencing or any of that, it was just trying to capture the building elevation. But certainly with the revised landscape plan we have, we could update that view so it presents a more accurate description of what it will look like in the future. A lot of the landscape comments have already been addressed on the new plan, and some of it's been changed, and we can let our landscape architect talk about that in a moment. And a lot of the details are really details you work through as we develop the management plan, as we develop drawings, and a lot of them will continually change. Some of the interior unit layouts may change, kind of out of the scope of 40B public hearing, but obviously relevant conversations to have. Some of those programming inside units and some of those details will change even now and as we move forward, and they may even change, some of them minor during construction because something comes up. So we appreciate all the details, and we will continue to work with the TVA and the town. Bike parking is a good one that we'll make sure is on the plan. It was a good point about the curbing, so the intention isn't to lose any spaces. So right now, I think it's a Cape Cod berm, so if it was had to be something like that in the future, we'll look into that. So obviously, you don't want to push cars much further into the street, so we'll have our civil engineer look at how to address that stretch test. That was a good point. We'll make that change and pick that up on the civil plan. So yeah, thank you for the detailed report.
Mr. Chairman, a question for the developer. I thought one suggestion made by the peer reviewer was the height of the central area for parking underneath the units or underneath the structure. 7'6" clearing area is a little bit lower, is less than. It's the height of some of the SUVs, the higher-end SUVs, which are 92 and 94 inches high. Not even discussing some of the concerns of the emergency vehicles that might be coming in there. My question to you is, he had indicated that perhaps the building needs, for the first floor, needs to be raised slightly for safety precautions down the road. I'm not concerned about that. If the developer is going to make the recommendations to town staff. But in the end result, you're asking the board to look at the waivers that you're requesting, and that's the page that I keep looking back at. But that has to be before the ZBA can make a determination. You're asking for those waivers, so some of these things which are being bantered back and forth need to be resolved before you ask for that final sheet of waivers before the board. So I assume that from taking the input from the peer reviewer, you're going to be looking at that and making some adjustments back to town staff, and that'll filter back to the board.
In terms of the waiver list, as I think town council will attest, it's always a fluid list that continues to get revised in many ways. One may be added. We actually, some of the consultants picked up a couple technical items that we added to the waiver list. And sometimes you may need something at the end of the day, and that waiver comes off the list. So those waiver lists is just, I think we prepared one just to show you what was originally proposed, where we're at now, and at the end of the day, it'll be a final one that takes in all this. I'll let the architect, Philippe Cruz himself, speak real quick to your point about the building height.
Thank you. Peter Bartosz with Cubree Studio. So I'd also like to clarify, as far as the height is concerned, there is a requirement within the building code that a portion of the garage from the point of entry to the accessible van space be no shorter than 8'2" clear to allow for that van access. So that is a strict rule that we have to meet regardless of what we do. In terms of what we're designing within the building section itself, our standard for projects of this type is actually 11-foot clear from the slab to the top of the podium slab, it's called. And so we've added an extra foot of height to the garage based on the developer's request to provide a little bit more ceiling height, in the amenity space, which is at the ground floor along the street front. So we've elevated the garage as it stands, and the 7'6" is really, in our cases, a conservative minimum. We're assuming as we get through the design process and all of the carrying members, the beams are sized, and we look at the way mechanical systems and plumbing, and gas system all comes down and gets coordinated, there may be areas within the garage that are at the lowest 7'6" to the underside of any of that piping or any of the other elements that come down below the slab. However, there will also be large portions of the garage that don't have any of that element other than what's up to the underside of the slab itself. So we're drawing a hard line and saying, conservatively, that is the quote-unquote height that we will advise people of as they're entering the garage through signage, through, you know, lowered bars that indicate what that height might be. But there will be other areas that you can access that are directly associated with that 8'2" clear that will be available for other people who might have larger cars. So, and we haven't seen that as an issue on any of our other projects in the between 4,000 and 6,000 units that we've designed and built in the last 5 years in this area.
And just to point out, so 7'6" is, I think, 90", and most, the tallest SUVs run around 77". I have one of them. But we did look at the garage at 30 Haven, too, just to see what that was, just to see, and they're actually, I believe it was a little under 7'6" garage height there. But clearly, you want to make sure all those tall SUVs can fit in the building, so.
I'm thinking of some of the larger emergency vans today. They keep growing in height so that the people can almost walk into them. And if that's the case, you're not doing it for today. You're doing it for 10 years or 12 or 15 or 20 years down the road also.
Clearly, there's an opportunity. You know, right now we're going to propose it's going to be private, like trash removal. And, you know, a trash vehicle isn't going to make it under there. You know, at some height, you do fit more vehicles under there, but you may fit them under today and not tomorrow, too. So it's trying to balance all those things, as well as balancing what the ultimate height of the building is also. So it's not that we're would be opposed to raising it, but we want to make sure it was done in a way that didn't have any more impact than what is proposed now. So
One observation about this. One of the things that makes this particular topic so tricky is because the way the site and building are configured, there are these two vehicular entrances to the functional entirety of the interior. Thank you. And then the site itself is surrounded so completely by tight access, and again, an absence of pullover. So I appreciate the point about 8'2", and just to clarify, the 6-figure was what we had in the conversation 2 days ago that the team had a conference call. And it's entirely appropriate to continue to evolve this. And I have little doubt, in fairness to the folks that have to design buildings for now and 10 years from now, and of course there's going to be a limit to know what happens for access here. But the one thing we do know is that based on that kind of height, it's quite limiting for certain kinds of emergency vehicles, service vehicles. And I honestly consider that to be the larger issue rather than the parking. It'll be clear for the vehicles. I'm confident work needs to be done through it, but I'm confident they'll be able to service the vehicles that are inclined to park or sought to seek to park there. But making sure that there's sufficient access, both vertically and vehicularly, that you don't want to have emergency vehicles interrupting traffic on your nearby streets. And so that's really
all right. Thank you very much. Thank you to the applicant. In the interest of making sure that the board has had an ample opportunity, do any board members want to make any commentary or ask any questions about anything that we've heard, either from the peer reviewers or the developer now, or do you want to hold all of your comments and questions? Because I think we still have a landscape architect again. Want to hold them until the end?
Yeah.
That's fine. So I guess what we'll do next is we'll invite the applicant's landscape architect to present.
Good evening. I'm Richard Catman. I'm a landscape architect from Holliston, Mass. I have a studio in Holliston. I'm a registered landscape architect in Massachusetts. My license number is 606. Just to give you a little background, I went to Rhode Island School of Design in 1973, graduated, and then went to work for a couple of very well-known landscape architectural firms in Boston. Carroll Johnson, which I worked on Regent Canal, and Cambridge Side Galleria for about 4 years, and at CBT Architects, where I worked on Shipyard Park next to the USS Constitution. And I've been working out of Holliston since 1988, and I started practice in 1974. I think what I'll do is actually, I'd like to move these forward a little bit, because I'd like to work from these more than I would from the plan.
I just want to make a point. For the purpose of the audience, this
right.
is a direct feed on cable. I don't know if cable can get into these. Just check our technical.
Okay. Let me. Okay.
Okay.
Great. I produced a plan which was then reviewed in peer review. And there were some very helpful comments, and I did make some changes to the plan based on the peer review. And what I'd like to do is first orient you to the site. This is Prescott Street. This is Lincoln Street. And I'm going to go through basically in a counterclockwise situation and talk about the north side, the west side, the south side, and then the east side. In terms of the planting that's proposed. So starting on the north side, this does involve a major change from what I had originally proposed. I originally had proposed lawn as a dominant feature in this location, based on the idea that there's a tremendous amount probably in the winter of snow plowing that occurs along this street. So I was trying to keep that relatively clean, but I do agree that it should have some mass plantings along this property and along the Prescott Street curve there. So I've changed it. And what you're seeing here are, if I can just move it a little bit. I have shown three clusters of Pieris japonica. Which is an evergreen shrub that does well in the shade and will stand up to the plowing conditions there, and is a relatively tall evergreen shrub in the 4 to 5 foot range. And then there are a massing along the street here of a dwarf spreading yew, which none of the maintenance contractors can turn into balls as they prune it, because it doesn't lend itself to that kind of pruning. So this is basically a massing of evergreen shrubs. But Andromedas flower white in the spring, and the dwarf spring yews will be evergreen throughout the year. And then here, I was showing some rhododendron boulevardage, which is a very small rhododendron that flowers white in the spring. Basically, all of this is north side. And I've tried to also plant, a lot of the site is shady, so I've used things that are shade tolerant in various locations. So moving to the west side, there's a cluster here of emerald green arborvitae, which can get 25 to 30 feet high. They're shade tolerant. It's a beautiful evergreen and produces a massive screen. And they would occur in this location. And then also here, there are three Japanese stewardias, which is a relatively unknown deciduous flowering tree. It grows about 25 to 30 feet high. It has four seasons of interest. It has exfoliating bark. It blooms all summer with a flower that looks like a camellia, and then it turns a bright crimson in the fall. So that would also be very helpful in screening. And also, I didn't mention, we're proposing a 6-foot high privacy fence the entire west and south property lines. That would provide, of course, 6 feet of screening at that level. But I'm also trying to introduce, through massing, some different kinds of plant materials that will help to screen, but also provide some interest. Also, this is a very sunny spot, so in a couple of locations I've introduced some very basic hardy shrubs, this being a cluster of forsythia, which is shown here, and then I'll describe moving along the south property line. At the south property line, again, there's some Thuja nigra, which is a dark American arborvitae. It's a little wider than the emerald green, which I've used here because of the narrow space. Again, it gets about 25 to 30 feet high, provides just a massive evergreen screen, and it's shade tolerant. So that occurs here and here and, in these three locations. The emerald greens are here and here, and then the dark American arborvitae, which are a little larger, are here and here, and then also here. So that that will provide massive blocks of screening along the western and the southern property line. Also, on the southern property line, showing, again, this is kind of a nice sunny location, so I was introducing a relatively modest planting of a dwarf lilac, Miss Kim, which would also provide some late spring bloom. So you're getting some color with early spring with forsythia and then some late spring with the Miss Kim lilacs. The three trees here are Cleveland pear, which gets quite tall but narrow. It's a white blooming tree. It blooms early spring. It's very, very, very hardy and quite beautiful to look at, but also very narrow. So it's very appropriate in these spaces. But it will also provide screening for the neighbors. Another thing that I wanted to mention is there are quite a number of trees along this property line. So there's some inherent screening that occurs without even introduction of new planting. So moving along at this corner of the south property line, I am introducing two very large October glory red maples. Again, that's a shade tolerant, large deciduous tree that will provide green all summer long, and then a really spectacular color in the fall. And they do get to be quite large, so I've introduced them in this location. There are also here and here four American holly, which is again an evergreen for heavy shade situation and very adaptable for screening. It has a red berry in the winter, and they would provide screening in this location and here as well. Also, in this entire corner, I've introduced a lawn with sod. And then there are two deciduous trees here, again, to provide, this is Coosa dogwood, which provides bloom practically all summer long, about 2 months. And then again, it has spectacular color in the fall. And it gets about 25 to 30 feet high as a deciduous tree. And then there's also a Miss Kim lilac here to sort of screen the trash amenity at that location. So moving along to Lincoln Street, vestibule entry. And it's a little changed on my plan. I changed it this morning. I'm introducing some dwarf Japanese Andromeda in that location. They are evergreen. I feel that they should be evergreen. A lot of the plant materials I've introduced are evergreen because we're in winter here 6 or 7 months of the year, and a planting plan really needs to look good in the off season as well as during summer when it's so beautiful. So I've introduced, you can see the plan's a little different there, five Japanese Andromeda here, dwarfs, and then also, which is this plan, but also I've introduced a massing of daylilies, which would be a sort of a yellow gold at the entry area here that would provide seasonal color all summer long. And then at the eastern area, I've provided a large area of lawn in that location. And that's basically the landscape plan that I've produced for this project. Thank you. And if you have any questions, I'd be glad to answer them, but I'm not sure what order you'd like to go through.
I have just a couple of short questions about your presentation. And again, forgive me for I'm going to lean on your knowledge of the height of these trees. Along the front wall where the corner of Prescott meets Lincoln, where the storefront facade is, how tall are the plantings going to be there? Are they going to cover up the storefront windows?
Right here?
Yeah.
No, these are very low.
Okay.
They're about 2.5 feet at the most. Same here, 2.5 feet. Because I thought this might be store windows, so I was keeping it very low. But here, there is a bit of a change in the heights, so that it would be a little musical rather than be just a long mass of shrubbery. So there are some taller 4 to 5 footers here, and then these are about 2.5 to 3 feet high. So there's a change in the heights. Here it's relatively higher, here and here, and then low there. But I was very concerned about having really durable plant materials here because of the snow blowing. So I've used spreading yew, which is, about as tough a material as you can get.
With regard to the, the south side, where you've had plantings, some larger and some smaller, I want to call into our discussion some concerns that the abutting neighbors have had regarding the units that will have balconies. And are those, taller, if you will, or wider canopy trees being placed strategically to perhaps provide a little bit more screening for the abutting property owners that might have concerns regarding privacy?
Well, basically what I've done on that side is I've attempted to screen it completely in certain locations. And then these trees would also fill up that space completely. So there are only a couple of areas here, for example, where there's a little bit of a low planting. Essentially, everything is in the range of 25 to 30 feet high along this entire property line. Will be eventually. When they're first put in, these trees will probably be 16 to 18 or 18 to 20 feet. But this entire property line, as I said, with the exception of a few locations where there are some smaller shrubs, it will be eventually screened to a height of 25 to 30 feet eventually.
When they're planted.
Okay, so as planted, they'll still reach above the 6 foot privacy fence.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. There's a plant schedule here. And for example, the fence is 6 feet high, and I called for to be 8 to 10 feet, which is, that's a pretty hefty plant in terms of nursery stock. That's a good $500 to $600 to $700 tree, so you'll have pretty instant impact. It will be above the fences, and they will do well and grow over time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Yes.
Yes.
Question, you just alluded to it at the end there, the fencing, and I didn't hear it in your discussion at all. Do you want to touch on the fencing that you plan along the south side?
Or
residential areas, right?
Yes, we were talking about a privacy fence, but working with the group, we all felt that that might be a decision that could be made by the abutters in terms of what the material would be.
I was going to ask that, if you coordinated this with the abutters.
We were discussing, of course, vinyl or wood. If it were wood, it might be a stockade fence. If it were vinyl, it would be also a stockade. But it would definitely be six feet high, and that's what we were hoping to have input for as to what would be preferred there. Vinyl can be quite reflective, and wood absorbs the sunlight. So, but vinyl is long range in terms of less maintenance and replacement over the years. So there are a couple of choices there.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, one other question.
Yes.
And maybe this isn't you, but looking at your landscape plan, I see it. What is the width of the sidewalks along Lincoln and Prescott?
What I've done in my plan is...
You're planting it,
this may require
about 5 feet.
Discussion, but
yeah.
What I've done in my plan is I've gone to the property line.
Right.
Which
and
is essentially what the town would do
okay.
in terms of improving the road.
Yeah.
So I showed a curb
right.
and then a sidewalk.
And
but
then
that may require some discussion back and forth
right.
as to what the length
okay.
of that is actually is.
Gotcha.
Yes.
Yeah, I have just one question too. The fence on the southerly and westerly side
yes.
was going to be now right on the property line.
No, I'm showing it 6 inches on our side.
And all the plantings are be on the
inside
of that.
Right. Yes.
So the immediate observation is going to be for the residents, but eventually, as time goes by, the fence actually is going to be replaced by your living fence.
Yes. Well, above the 6 foot fence.
Yeah. Okay.
Did you want to add something?
Just two quick points, Mr. Chair. We've had a discussion about the three balconies that are shown there. So as we have comments now from TVA, we're going to remove those when we do our next round of revisions on the architectural drawing. So those will go away. And it's also deceiving because right now the existing building is literally on the property line, if not over the property line.
Yeah.
So when you pull it back, there's some room there, and then there's that the existing sidewalk, and trying to figure out as we move forward how to treat that sidewalk, whether it should stay that width or be less or be more, or because it's the town owns the sidewalk.
Right.
So we're happy to have those discussions. We get into that detail. But the building's actually pulled back.
Oh, one more question. In your leasing, are you going to permit pets, such as small dogs? I only say that because we have a very limited grass area
to walk.
Not that it's got anything to do with the zoning board, so aspect of it.
It's the one to see it, so we haven't thought about
it. It's part of that plan to figure out those details of operation and management,
Thank you.
I think that is the end of the presentation that we have scheduled for tonight. And so I'm going to turn it over to the members of the board who go in order to see who might have questions or comments or information that they need or want to share. We'll start with you, John, if you want to do that.
The questions, I guess, would first be from our planning staff. So Gene and Julie, you've been meeting with the developer and the peer review individuals over the last couple of weeks. I think we have the the memo from Julie, but even that is probably a little bit on the older side too. So how are we progressing? That's what I think is important. The board knows, but I don't think the public knows where that stands right now.
Give it over.
So I'm
That memo was drafted today.
Oh, okay.
So that's pretty much where we're at.
Okay. I'm looking at the time. I'm looking at the time aspects of it too.
Yep.
Where we're moving.
Yep.
Okay. Then for now, that's fine.
Robert?
No. Yes, thank you, John. I have a few comments here, and I'll try to keep them brief. I know you've touched on a number of them already. Again, like John, I'm concerned with the parking. 72 spaces, 72 units seems small to me. I think I need more convincing that that's adequate. I suppose if you, it's designated that they're to people, and when they do come in, that they know they get one space per unit, period. That's it. No visitor parking, nothing else. I suppose that would have to be the way to go if you do have the 72 spaces on that. But then, as John says, and I'm concerned, medical parking, taxis. Obviously, if somebody doesn't have a car, they may be taking a taxi. Is a taxi expected to pull in or drop them off near the elevator or drop them off outside maybe if it's inclement weather? What about I'm thinking visiting nurses? So visiting nurses, if they make trips to the unit or something like that, they would need a place to maybe temporarily park for half an hour, 45 minutes, or something like that. On that, again, I think it's been alluded to people moving in and out. Obviously, the 72 unit apartment complex. There is going to be turnover on a monthly, bi-monthly basis or something, and you know, how's that to be worked out? I think we need a plan on that, or at least a narrative on how that's going to work on that. And the rubbish and trash, how's that to be worked out? We need a narrative or something or a plan on that, how that's going to be worked out. Certainly the two elevators, as the architect peer review alluded to that, or noted, that is certainly an improvement over the previous plan. And I think the landscaping certainly provides better privacy for the abutters along the south side, west sides, and I guess, south, east, west, there. Except for Prescott and Lincoln there, the abutters there. On that, I was going to note the fencing, and then you did note tonight that, yeah, fencing was in your ideas with the landscaping. And I was going to note that I would think you would want to correspond with the abutters in regards to the type of fencing and get their input in regards to what you plan to plant along their property line, and also the type of fencing to go in. I don't think you're going to have, you know, if one wants vinyl, one wants stockade, one wants something else. No, it's all going to be one type of fence. And I think, you know, if they have some type of meeting or at least work with them on that. And then the other thought on that too, you are planting right up to the property line, putting your fence in right up to the property line or 6 inches off it. Are you going to need temporary construction easements from the abutters? I would suspect that you're going to have workers stepping onto their property. Maybe not, but I would expect that if you're planting shrubs and good-sized trees, you're going to be very close to their property line, and you would be have workers, construction workers, on their property, or stepping on it. Still concerned with, and I think I mentioned it in the first go around here, the stormwater control. You're still looking at groundwater recharge with stormwater for collection on the roof of the building, and groundwater recharge via the tanks or structures inside the parking lot under the pavement, right? And I assume the engineers will be looking at that, civil engineer peer review, et cetera. But I'm concerned, you know, that the soils are gonna be able to take that groundwater recharge. And again, the height of the parking for structures, you've heard that one, and I think that's a concern. Let's see, the sidewalk widths that I had mentioned just a few minutes ago, that's a concern, but I know that's something you will be building up to your property line. Then I think you have to coordinate with the town and what they're looking for sidewalks there. I would suspect that they're looking for a minimum 5 foot wide with curbing, and whether they want a planting strip or not, I don't know, but that's something you will have to work out with the town, I believe. And a question I have for you. Now, you they've alluded to it in the architectural plans, that a lot of glass front in the corner there at Prescott Lincoln. It looks like a storefront. Is there any plans for commercial use at that corner? I would think not. This is strictly all residential, right? Okay.
That space is designated now as like a area, common space area.
Right.
So we haven't designed it yet. So there'll be, you know, that use of it. It's not a unit.
Yeah.
So there
yeah.
is some use to the building, to, you know, some other ideas we've talked about that as we design it, we'll kind of see what shapes. But we, you know, I think the idea was the look of the building to make that fit in on that corner, to make it feel like it is more of a commercial corner. That's the work that we're concerned with.
Okay. Thank you. So that's some of the comments that I have after looking at the plans and hearing your presentations tonight. Thank you. Eric?
Thanks, Bob. So I'm just looking at kind of where we are in the process, and I know that we have November kind of right around the corner, and we probably won't be meeting, I would imagine, for about another month. So I just wanted to just make sure that we're all kind of moving on the same course here. And I think probably at that time it would be appropriate to have some written narratives, as Bob was mentioning, about the trash, the snow, the loading, the moving. You know, we've kind of been kicking that can down the road with the design remodel. And, you know, I do think it's an appropriate time now to kind of get in and see how those would practically work. Again, I think that the parking is, you know, potentially problematic. You've asked for a waiver here, you know, to reduce the required parking from 1.5 to 1. I mean, no slight against you guys. I mean, I know you're developers. You probably didn't set out to create a transit-oriented development. It's really probably just a case of happy geography, you know, that the lots became available. I'm not totally convinced that that one space per unit is appropriate. So I know that you've indicated that you're willing to work with the town and private companies. I would like to maybe see a written narrative of what could happen with that. I don't know if you're looking into long-term leases there, but I know that it's a concern for me personally, broadly for the board, and obviously for the community, particularly the abutters. You happen to pick, I think, the Haverhill Line's most busy actual hub. So there's, I think I read online, maybe like 800 commuters use that. So there is a lot of overspillage, even along the streets there. If you were to go there at peak times, you'd see them, you know, lined up the road for about, you know, at least a quarter mile there. So it would be nice to see some effort on that part. Like I said, I think you've made a case for the transit oriented development for the space, but I mean, realistically, you would need a car to get around Reading. I mean, it's not a place that you could walk. Typically, those types of developments are marked by mixed use development, and I know that this is strictly residential. So if you can make some sort of an effort on that, particularly, you know, with some sort of specific plans there, working with the town and with the private spaces available, I think everyone would, you know, appreciate that. That's all I have.
Thank you. And I agree with my fellow members of the ZBA. I, too, am very concerned about the parking. It's a very congested area. And I do recognize that we are across from a commuter rail station. But we have to remember, it's not an MBTA station where you can take the T at any time you want. It's a commuter rail, there's a set schedule. People aren't taking the T to the grocery store. You are gonna need a car to get around Reading. And there are no pickup and drop-off locations. Nowadays with Uber and things of that nature, people are coming and going with things like that, but there's nowhere even to pick up or drop off with something of that nature here. No bike racks. So I think going forward, in the interest of time, for me, it's just I would like to see some more definitive answers to some of these questions that we've had. This has been an ongoing process, and I know a lot will change, and there are still questions that need to be answered. But just some specifics would be helpful at the next meeting, not only to myself, I'm sure, but to the residents of the specific area that have to be concerned about this development and the traffic and other headaches that it may cause for them. So thank you.
Okay, I have, you know, we started this thing in February, and there's been a lot of discussion, a lot of input from you and from the people from the town who've attended these meetings and the board. And, you know, I would certainly acknowledge, I think, and I get that sense from everyone, there's no one in this town is opposed to what we want to do here, what's trying to be done here. I think this could be a very, very beautiful asset to the community, as long as it's not detrimental to the character of the town and to the neighborhood in which you want to put it. I think your latest proposal to take one floor off the property, off the proposal, is a really a good, clean step in the right direction. But I still, there are some concerns I have relative to a few issues, some of which have been raised already. And there's a lot of other issues that have been put on the table so far that haven't been discussed or presented this evening. And I'd just like to go through them from my perspective. As we move forward to trying to bring this thing to a closure. Number one, I think density is still a major issue. Going from five floors to four floors is a definite improvement in density. I know there was one resident that offered a suggestion way back then as to whether or not they ever considered three floors. And, you know, whether that, you know, my view of that sort of thing is it would certainly solve a lot of the problems. I think it would end up being a very, very, very attractive piece of property on that real estate. And, you know, I haven't gone through these things like you guys have, I haven't done it many times before, but I would like to have someone convince me that why that is not still economically feasible. Safety is an issue to me. Safety encompasses a lot of things. It involves, I'm talking safety in terms of the people going to live in this complex. I'm talking about safety of the people going to walk by this complex, drive by this complex. The facility access on the part of all kinds of vehicles, whether they be emergency or trash pickup or whatever it may be. So I'd like to see some good dialogue on that one relative to how we're going to handle all that stuff in a very, very, very safe way. Parking has been brought up by everybody. That is a really major issue. And I think that really needs to be discussed a little more and thought through a little more. And as I think Eric or one of them mentioned, I'd like to see that final proposition put in writing. The height of the parking area on that first floor, to me, is just unacceptable in its current phase. I don't know whether you could go up in that height, which would mean you could make the height of the building a little higher. I don't know whether you ever considered going down, okay, into the ground to make that, to solve that problem. But that in my judgment, as one member of this board, that's got to be solved. There are a lot of Other issues, snow removal is a real problem, I see. You're not gonna have a lot of room to put it. And so I'd like to see a good plan on how that's going to be done. A lot of things that weren't brought up tonight, such as the utilities, gas, electric, oil, water, and sewer, drainage, lighting, shadowing, impact on school system. These are not, these are things that need to be resolved, but in my view, as one member of the board, I do not consider those showstoppers. I consider those all things that can be worked out within the context of the total plan, and I'm not bothered by those. The ones that bother me are safety, density, parking, and the like. I noticed one observation, though. You did put two elevators in instead of one, but they're all located at one end of the facility, and the handicap spaces are at one end of the facility. This is, for the people who are gonna be occupying way down the far end, they got a long walk to get to where those are. I don't know whether you've ever considered putting an elevator at one place and another one at the other end of the park, okay? Or putting the handicapped parking spaces anywhere. You know, we don't live in a world of one-car families anymore. If there's four people living there, you're probably gonna have four cars to deal with. Who knows? And I realize that, you know, you made the comment, I think, earlier, that, you know, people are gonna look at investing in this property and buying into the property based on what they see. And if they see for themselves parking's an issue, they'll go find some other place to deal with it. And I understand that. I think a lot more thought has to go into the parking. So we're making progress. I think you guys have done a heck of a job. You're moving in the right direction. Progress has been made. And I think everyone in this town realizes that this takes time. And but time is money. Time is expensive. And so I think we need to begin that process of finalizing these issues and moving toward a decision. I'd like to see the final best and final responses to the peer review comments and discussions you have with them, so that we end up with a documentation of what is the final posture on this thing in terms of where you want to go. And the other thing I'd also like to start taking a look at is the town's position on these issues, the various departments in the town who are involved in some of these critical areas and their inputs as well. And I would suggest, Mr. Chairman, that come the next meeting, we should hear some more inputs, but I would recommend that we begin the process of drafting a decision on this case, subject to obviously markups and editing as we get more and more information. I mean, the end of the road is coming based on the extensions we have so far, and so I think we need to begin that process. That's all I have at the moment.
I don't want to echo what the other DBA members, so I do have a few points. For me, parking, it is an issue, but not so much with the ratio. I am familiar with many of the TOD studies, and I think you even mentioned one for the town of Reading did. For me, parking is more of a concern with the lack of drop-off space and pickup space. We are, you know, moving to the future where people are less dependent on the car, and they are more dependent on other services, e-commerce, delivery. You can get your food delivery with Peapod. And given the tenure and the number of one bedrooms, I don't see a lot of, you know, units with two or three cars. But that being said, I do think, you know, to echo the other points, there needs to be a drop-off and a pickup area for services for the tenants. One other issue was the setback for the east, south, and west in the landscaping. I know there's not a lot of space there to landscape. And I believe you mentioned that you were in talks with the abutters about the fencing material. I would also am wondering if you guys would be making landscape design services available to the abutters so they would have an opportunity to get consultation on what they can do on their property to mitigate the sight lines. That would be an option. And that's really my comment.
I have one concern that I did bring up before, And that is on the list of waivers, you're asking for a waiver from loading zone. I have a major concern for a lack of a loading zone in a 72-unit complex with the maintenance of the facility, the building, but also I don't see how you're going to move in 72 people or 72 units worth of people without a loading facility. You can't use Lincoln Street to have the moving trucks drop off during the course of the day when that is a major access to the MBTA. I think a loading zone or site or location somewhere on the property is almost a necessity. I do have a concern about that. Again, it's from my previous experiences. And there's one thing that we haven't talked about. I know it's down the road, and we haven't even got there yet, but I didn't see it listed anywhere, and that is a construction set of plans, how we're going to put, when this is granted, how we're going to put this up. What do we need to do for that as we move towards the reality of making this a 40B project? I'm not asking for it now because it's far enough down the road, but it does have to be addressed because you do have a very dense site and you are going to impact the major thoroughfare for the town of Reading just because of the MBTA. So it needs to be addressed, and in past 40Bs it's always been addressed with the town staff, but we haven't started yet, so when it comes up. Sorry, David.
Thank you. I have just a couple comments, I guess, maybe additional questions, requests. I'm not going to hammer home again. You know, you're working on the parking issue. We've heard that. There is a list in the package that I think the applicant has about some outstanding list items, as well as some of the things that have been identified tonight. I'd like to see those addressed, if not, hopefully by the next meeting. The extent that they're still outstanding, I can read them into the record, but you've got a copy of the memo, so I'll refrain from that. I haven't seen, I don't think, an updated list of which units you're going to designate as affordable, as you did in your original proposal. I don't know if you produced it, but I'd like to see it. You know, as far as the engineering and civil goes, I mean, you're going to leave that to for you to get with the engineers on, you know, the turn radius and traffic and the water capacity, drainage capacity, sewer testing, you know, that's for you to go over with the engineering folks. But one thing I think that's hasn't been spoken about yet is, I think now that we've gone through a process where we've had the peer reviewers in, and everybody has had a chance to get a look at the amended application, that, you know, this is a new application that we're, with the addition of the Brown parcel, this is a new application that we're dealing with now. So I don't think it's necessarily appropriate. I think we've all recognized the improvement from the original submission to what you're submitting now. I think it's important moving forward that we speak of and focus on the proposal that is before the board today. And that is an updated proposal with the inclusion of the extra parcel, with the design and the drawings that you produce right now, and that we perhaps get away a little bit from comparing to how much better it is than the old project and whether or not the new project as proposed is appropriate. And so I think we're getting there, and the dialogue is good. I think we've talked a little bit about timelines. I think in the memo that we got from town staff today, we'd like to, at least by the next meeting, and we haven't decided when that's going to be yet, to
to perhaps have a start at a decision going as best we can to try to keep this process moving forward. And hopefully we can incorporate some of those waiver items that you've had in there. As I went through the waivers list, I mean, other than 4, 5, and 6, which I think you've already beat to death and I know that you're working on, none of those waiver requests to me jump out at me as terribly unreasonable. And I looked at it briefly when I saw the new waiver list come out. You know, that's just my opinion, having looked at them, and I know you're working at some of those other items as well, but I'd like to try to see our decision begin to focus on some of those waiver items as well. With that said, I'm going to thank the our public tonight for being patient this far through the night, and I'm going to turn the forum over for public comment. Again, if you'd like to speak, raise your hand. Wait to be recognized. When you speak, please rise if you can. Identify yourself by name and address, and address your comments to the board in a respectful manner. If it requires a response from the applicant, we'll give them an opportunity to respond. Thank you.
Right in the back.
Nick Gagnon, 76 Washington Street. So two comments. First one on the landscaping, just pointing out that so really appreciate the effort of the developer trying to provide the abutters with some privacy, but one comment that I have about the choice of plants, so arborvitaes, it's true that they grow to 25 to 30 feet, but for practical reason, they're typically not maintained to that height. You have to prune them to keep them in a good looking shape. And pruning trees, meaning trees at a height of 30 feet, is very, very challenging. So typically they're maintained more at the 12 to 15 feet height. So that doesn't provide a whole lot of screening for the abutters. And then my other comment is about parking. Everything that I think has been said already, but I just want my comment to be on the record. I saw a document on the town's website submitted by the developer about the potential proposal to use on-street parking in the neighboring streets. And I would just like to point out that, you know, the issue has to be framed beyond just for visitors of the complex, but also for residents. If a couple lives in this building and has two cars, then that means one of the cars use on-street parking. As an example, my street, Washington Street, is heavily used by commuters. So one additional spot taken by a resident of this complex is one less spot for the rest of the town that uses the commuter rail. And I would also like to point out that in terms of access to Washington Park on game nights, for example, these parking spots are completely full. So if you have residents using those spots, then access to the park is decreased. And then finally, during the winter, there's no overnight parking on that street because of plowing, because the street is very narrow, so I don't see how that would work for a couple owning two cars living in that building. That's it.
Thank you. Mrs. Downing.
Hi, Marianne Downing, 13 Heather Drive, and I wanted to go to your comment about the one spot per unit coming from a town study. And hopefully planning can chime in. Most of us who live here know this was a 2009 study, 7 years ago before we put in the 40R, and it's referring to the Atlantic in the present tense. We know the whole town's been reconfigured. But since the developers want to refer to the standard in that study, I decided to read that and the other report, and there's some other things we should note in the study. No, we don't have it. The Institute of Traffic Engineers came up with a table that your consultants used in the study, and the one spot per unit for urban settings. In fact, the report recommends that you decouple parking from apartments and charge people for it. It cites examples in like San Francisco and Portland and all these places that we know are really applicable to renting. But the Institute of Transport Engineers says 1.2 spots per unit in a suburban setting. And it was saying, you know, Reading's requirement of 1.5 might be high. So I'd like the ZBA to go
anyone in the town who's want to make deals with the developer about parking, go look again at these reports and decide if the one spot per unit is still applicable. I don't know why the reports were commissioned, but my recollection, I think, was trying to decide if the town should build a garage for our redevelopment, so we want to use it for the right purpose. And just one last comment with parking. I was doing, playing around with numbers and thinking if we wanted to get to 1.5 per unit and fit them in that garage, you'd have to go down to, what, I mean, you probably know this, you'd have to go down to like 48 units, so that would be two floors of 24, or you could go to 1.2, like the ITE says, and it would be in the low 50s, I don't remember the number. So I please don't grant that waiver on one spot per unit. As you've mentioned, there's going to be an issue with on-street parking, and then you're going to give people at Reading Village a privilege that we in Reading don't have. I mean, we may park on the streets, but in the winter we don't have the right to do so. And it shouldn't be something that's applicable to only one building in town. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Stephen. I live in 38 Lennon Street. I got two quick questions and then a comment. First, what is the total number of peer review consultants that we have? Are we going to hear from civil engineering at the meeting? And the other question, which may be for the developers, but I was going to ask as well, is the entire development rental units, or is there going to be a rent and condo units, or all rental? I have to say that the getting a third parcel together really makes this a vast better project. I can remember the first time I came here, saw it, was this is much better. I just want to congratulate the developers for making this lot more palatable and making these three places, the storage, retailer, auto shop, like this is phenomenal. I mean, you know, there's really not a lot you can do better for development. And the last thing I've got here is on some of the visualizations that you've shown on the screen, there's a large or a brick face, and I know in other places that I've seen that has a tendency to do some kind of advertising. I was wondering if there had been any thought or discussion to what sort of treatments we're going to go on to the brick face, which I believe is like behind where the elevators. I can imagine that, you know, entrepreneurial person would see that face that goes directly towards the station is going to find that a very valuable place for advertising, and I'm sure that someone is interested. So I was hoping to hear maybe a little bit of comment.
Hi, Christine Hansen, 30 Haven Street here in Reading. I have several questions relative to accessibility. I know that a number of the board members have raised questions about loading, unloading, pickup, drop off, etc., mentioning Uber, Zip cars, and such other things. We have a large number of seniors and disabled, particularly residing in that area and hoping to reside in that area. They use paratransit. there is no notation on any of the plans as to where a paratransit vehicle, whether it be MassTran, the Ride, the Senior Van, Sanborn Van, Windsor Place Van, for guests, et cetera, would be able to pull it off. Also, based on the fact that you have one bedroom, the potential thing is great. So they would need that type of an accessibility feature. In addition to that, the width of the sidewalks, the ramps that would be provided. One question I had relative to the parking, there are handicap accessible parking spaces, yet the area in which a van would open their doors, you're actually sharing it with the space exactly next to it. So that poses a question. The other question is the distance from the handicapped parking spaces to the elevators, to the common area. Also, the location of the handicap apartments themselves. How close are they to the elevators? What provisions are made for medical accessibility, for emergency plans? There is no second exit or egress on the far end. The concern is, as the architectural review noted, that the furthest apartments are about 200 feet from the elevator area. So that becomes a question as well. So I think I would request that the board look at the accessibility features to this building. Thank you.
Julia Galloway, 25 Prescott Street. I had just three issues to bring up. Number one, I think it should be a three-story building. This building, what is there now, was built over 100 years ago when Reading was a very industrial town, had lots of warehouses and factories, so four stories was kind of normal. It's not that anymore. I think it should be three stories. Prescott is not a downtown street. It's a residential neighborhood. My other issue is if they're not going to provide any outdoor space for their tenants, they're going to be using Washington Park, so they should be paying the town some sort of fee annually, because there'll probably be lots of people. There's 70 units there, lots of people utilizing the park. And my final issue is with the frontage on Prescott Street, I still feel like it won't be safe for when a car is pulling out. I just measured my car, my little compact car, and it's like 5 feet from the bumper to the steering wheel. So I'd have to stick the car out and go actually into the sidewalk. And I know there's lots of people walking up and down that sidewalk, lots of kids riding bikes on that sidewalk. I feel it's dangerous. So thank you very much.
On the west side, the landscaping there, the building goes right to the very edge. I don't remember exactly how many feet it is, but if you intend to put a 20 to 30 foot bush there, there's not a lot of windows in your apartments. They're like one window on each end or something, and down the very end, people are not going to want their window entirely covered by a tree, not to mention then that takes away the privacy to the next house because the building is so close to the edge of the property. I personally feel the building not only should be down one height, as was mentioned, but it also should be squished in so it is not taking up every single maximum space in that property. I think it infringes on a lot of people's use around there, not only parking, but the people who live there. And having those bushes right against, I think, is not very good.
Mr. Blodgett.
Edward Blodgett, 99 Prescott Street, and a member of Walkable Ready. I have two issues. One is major sewage and infrastructure. In March of 2010, there were 3 days that presented 4 to 5 inches of rain each day. And that was 3 years before that, I don't remember, I can't find exactly when they were, when Prescott Street backed up and people's cellars had sewage in them, toilets got blown out of the cellar in certain locations. I think 72 units is huge on the infrastructure. It's interesting that it was stormwater that presented the problem. This would be the problem if you had that many units in the sewer system automatically. The other issue I'd like to bring up is the walkability of Prescott Street. There's dozens to hundreds of people that walk Prescott Street every single day, and I have a huge concern of the slide of snow from the edges of angles of roof of the dormers, up next to the dormers. You set the building back 4 to 5 feet. You have an eave that comes out 2 feet. That snow is going to slide, and it's going to project out right onto the sidewalk. That is a huge accident waiting to happen. I think the building has to be set back further. I too am that there was a pleasant move from 4 stories to 3. I think it would be better if it went down one more and you made parking. I was recently in Florida, and the parking was so hot you could not get in with a conventional car. And I do not have a big car. You just couldn't get in with all these posts and structures. The parking is very, very difficult. So if they would reduce the size of the building and the number of units, they could make the parking better and leave loading and places like that available. Thank you.
Mary Ellen O'Neill, 125 Summer Avenue. Before I make my comments, I do want to specifically ask the ZBA not to grant the waiver for the density at this level. It's too high, it's too much. And I also ask that they not grant the waiver for the front setback. It's much too narrow for a lot of reasons, including what Everett said. One of the unappealing features of the Doucette building is it looks like a wall. So now we've added grounds and we have a huge wall. I find this a very unattractive building. I look at it both from resident in town and someone who thinks about downsizing. I would never downsize to this particular building because it strikes me as a very poor quality of life with no outdoor space, a cramped feeling. It looks like a wall. I just look at it and say, I wouldn't want to live here. I think it should be between 45 and 50 units max. I think you ought to break up that wall along Prescott Street. I don't know why Lincoln Street was chosen as the front. I think there should be two front entrances, Prescott and Lincoln. You know, break up that wall feeling and make it, attractive and residential feeling and more livable and a better quality of life, because you have a fair number of three-bedroom units, you're gonna have children, and not everyone with young children wants to run down to the park all the time. It's not a big, has a lot of space with a baseball field. There's not a lot of space, otherwise. It's one of the smaller parks. So if you really want, it's a great piece of property. It's a very valuable location. You're gonna get your money back, I think, with the rents that you can charge, and that if you make it a nice building. Right now it looks ugly, I'm sorry. So I hope you consider downsizing it, redesigning it to break it up and break that big wall along Prescott, and just give it much more green space. There won't be room for a tree lawn. It's a very hot area down there. Make that front lawn on Prescott bigger, put in some nice shade trees, and just do things that make people want to live there. Thank you.
Jim Thomas is 21 Arlington Street. I think you brought up the exits, the signaling, the safe stop. I've mentioned this before, but I'm concerned about the lighting and the sound at your exit and entry points. Regarding the facade, I believe in at least one of the drawings, it looked as though there were doors along Prescott Street. It looked as though the window was broken up with something that looked, I think it was orange blocks that looked, maybe that's a design feature and not. Are they doors?
Are you asking about the garage doors?
No, along Prescott Street where the plants are now, it looked as though there were a couple of entries in one of your drawings. No, it was a design feature.
Okay.
So finally, for the glass, which would be considerable, is that frosted or clear glass? So you're going to be walking past and looking at a garage and cars, or I would look, like to go on record just saying that I would hope that could be frosted glass. Thank you.
Yeah, Mrs. Blodgett.
Virginia Blodgett at 99 Prescott Street. I just have one comment. I heard someone a few minutes ago use the word palatable. I think that's pretty sad if that's what we're happy with, is palatable.
Any further comments, questions?
All right, I'm going to go ahead and close the public comment portion of tonight's hearing. Any other members of the board have any other comments or questions?
I just have one. What's your target population for rentals? We seem to be talking about who is going to be renting, but we haven't really figured that out. In my mind, I think I know who they are. But I want to see what you would say are the target population, because they're all, basically, they're all one bedroom units.
So, obviously, there's, whoever will rent, I mean, to be fair housing, you can't get into those details, but, and it's not actually a 40B question, but our target, I think we'll have a mix. I think we've heard some people with seniors, which is a good point, people downsizing. I think we will get, some millennials and people. As I know the rents as you go from Boston out this way and how they incrementally change for the new building on the train. So you'll get people that will commute, it's not a train key, but they'll commute to their job in Boston because they know what they could afford a month, and this is cheaper than what may be two spots closer, which is cheaper than two spots closer. And then you'll also, get, there may be some divorcees that want to stay in town, so in the middle between the seniors and maybe the millennials. So I think you'll get a mix. We have the three bedrooms as required under the state code. You never quite know. I mean, you may get a few families in those. And so I think our intent was originally people that wanted to rely on being right by the train, the commuter rail, and being close to downtown. And the more we hear, I think the senior points are good points. And I think as downtown Reading gets more developed from a retail point of view, which I think is the goal of everybody, it seems like the goal of what the town is looking for. I think having services for those different groups of people will be important for the growth of downtown, which has a tremendous potential to grow in a positive way. So I think that we're looking at a mix of those type of groups of people. But you also never know at the end of the day how buildings shake out. And I just wanted to make one quick point. I think the parking ratio discussion is a very good discussion. There's no answer. It's not like I see, people study it. There's people who live there and they kind of know, and we see it. And so it's a good discussion to continue having. So we made some points that we thought are relevant, but there's some good points that have been made. So we'll continue to look at that ratio. And I think the loading is another good point that's been discussed a lot that we'll take under advisement. So we appreciate those comments, and I'm sure they will continue.
All right, thank you very much. The next, I guess, item for discussion is when the next hearing is going to be. We're going to probably continue out. We've been doing a minimum of 30 days. You know, I think we, as a board, I know town staff would really like to see, you know, a number of the board members have asked for some written materials, narratives, a list that was provided in Julie's memo earlier for some outstanding information to the extent it's still outstanding. So if we're going to push out, continue for 30 days and perhaps at that time maybe have an initial, perhaps an initial draft of a decision going, I guess that depends on how ready we are to write one up. But if that's what we're shooting for, we're looking at August 18th, which is a bit of a problematic date for the board. I'm not around, another member's not around. I wish I could say I was on vacation, but I'm actually on trial. conducting a trial.
On trial.
Sorry. So, depending upon how long the applicant needs to put together the additional items that were requested and have been requested, perhaps some outstanding items, the next available date after that, sorry for the feedback, would be September 15th. So that would actually be pushing it out 2 months, and perhaps we ought to have a bit of a discussion now as to whether or not we think we're better off pushing it out 2 months. Well, if we push it out to the 18th, then there's always a chance there may be a quorum issue if somebody else perhaps can't make it that night. You know, if we want to keep it for that night and somebody cancels, then we have a backup date. I mean, somebody on the board cancels. Or we could just push it up to September 15th with a view toward giving both the applicant and the town to complete all the submissions that are outstanding and review the submissions, and perhaps have a more complete or a more substantive draft decision. I guess I would defer a little bit to town staff on that.
David?
I think you could make the 18th work.
How about the 25th? Would that be
good
for you?
Same thing.
Yeah, I mean, just cancel the 18th and move it up a week to the 25th, if that would work.
Exactly.
I don't know how that works for you, David, or for Kathleen. I don't.
Was that an open night, August 25th? Could we have that as an open night? You know, if there anything scheduled
that works
that
for
night,
the developer,
that would conflict with it town-wise.
I'm not aware of anything.
Never mind.
I don't see anything on the town website.
Well, perhaps we could do that then. Maybe just push it out 5 weeks into it, August 25th. What do you think about that?
I think given where we're at, I know we're with the civil drawings, that we're really pretty close. We've been trying to coordinate with the town when to submit those, so the peer review could be the only time to get comments. So we're pretty close on those. Some of the operation and management stuff we've already drafted, so I think we'd like to do. I mean, I always hate making the board, asking the board to come in on a non-scheduled night, but I think the 25th, we would prefer that, but we'll leave it obviously up to the.
All right, why don't we plan to, I'm sorry, Bob, yeah.
You want to take a quick check
with the rest of the board?
Take a check.
Board, think the 25th works?
How's the 25th work for board members? Looks like everybody's
agreeable
to that day.
Okay. All right, why don't we say that we'll continue now until Thursday, August 25th. At this point, I'm going to close the hearing. Thank everybody for their attendance and cooperation. See you August 25th.